Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
So we're ready for the third talk. If any of you taught a class and had students submit joint homework, you'll see what I was feeling when I saw that, you know, suddenly my speakers are starting to collaborate between each other. Anyway, we're very happy to have Yishay tell us about robust inference and local algorithms.
Thank you very much, Yuval. And many thanks to my co-author, Uriel Feige, Aviad Rubinstein, Rob, which is here. We will be more than happy to answer any questions that you have. This is why you take a course to talk. Moshe Tennenholtz and Shai Vardi. So this is sort of the plan of the talk. So mainly I would like to convince you that robust probabilistic inference is an interesting and idea and an interesting question. I'll start with giving a few motivating examples and a model, and then sort of describe the main results, and hopefully we'll get enough time to give a sample of our results. As a warning for those guys who report to Jennifer, I did give a similar talk in both places, but it's only similar up to the model. After the model's results are different, do not tune out. They probably predicted, but they never wrote it. Okay, so when I say robust probabilistic inference, what do I mean? So like in Hebrew, let's read it from right to left. Inference, so when we talk about an inference problem, sort of it's a mapping from observation to an event, right? So you see certain things about the world and you want to deduce something about what was the state of the world. When we say probabilistic, sort of I mean that the underlying events have a joint probability distribution. Those of you more from a machine learning side, just think about a Bayesian network. A Bayesian network is a way to describe a joint distribution, and what you're observing the values at some nodes and want to predict a value at other nodes. So what's new here is robustness, because the other two are well known. So robustness is the new feature, and the way to think about it is the possibility that what you observe is not what really happened. It's a possibility that what you observe is really has been corrupted by someone. So let me give two motivating examples. So the first one is spam detection. So when you think about the spam detector, this has a huge number of filters. Each filter works on a tiny bit of information and trying to find out maybe who sent it, how is the email structured, keywords like Viagra, key things like please enter your login, etc. Given all this, the idea of a spam detector is to collect all this information, have those various filters work, and from them to deduce whether the email is a spam or not. But when you think about a spam detection, you really realize it's more like a game. Because on the one hand side, I guess the good guy side, are the one who are trying to detect whether it's spam or not. But on the other hand, the spammers are also playing the game. So in some sense, when you set up a spam detector, if you leave it running by itself for a very long time, it's very likely that spam will get through it. Because the spammer will be able to sort of overcome more and more of the filters. So if you think about the spammer can adjust the context to detectors, and what you would like to think that in the short run, they probably would be able to fool a few detectors. As I said, in the long run, they would probably be able to fool a huge number of detectors. So what is our goal in robustness here? The goal is to classify the email correctly, even if the spammer can adversarially corrupt a few of the detectors. So by corrupt, think that sort of they wrote a word with a spelling error, they have all those tricks to get around the filters that we did put. So let's think that they can fool a few number of detectors, and we would like to be able to overcome it. Yes, question.
Assume here the spammers here know they are spammers, because most spam I receive is people who don't realize.
It's So you mean people who send us like the weekly MSR? No comment. Another setting is like any real setting. I like to think about a network failure architecture because I'm familiar with networks. So a network is something very complex. In every network, you have a huge number of failures, unlike what we like to think in theory that everything works. But in order to sort of manage the failure, sort of what would really happen is that you'd put detectors. So really, in order to solve the failure problems, you're putting more hardware into the network. For example, you're trying to detect whether some leak is operational or not, whether the error, the bit error rate on the link is high or low, but those detectors can fail. So when we think fail, most of you probably think, oh, it doesn't work. But if it doesn't work, this is the easy case. The hard case, if you have something that wants to detect the bit error rate, and it gives you a reply that the bit error rate is 0.01. Yeah, it could be 0.01, in which case you have like a flaky link, or it could be that the detector went bad. So how can you model such a thing? Things are going to fail, especially if you have like a huge network like Microsoft. You can think about it, a sort of modeling it like in a Bayesian sense. What does it mean when to model in a Bayesian sense? It really means that you sort of assume what would happen in the failure. This is what you really need to do. On the other hand, you can try to sort of to model it in the worst case. And this is what I will advocate now. So modeling in the worst case, you really are trying to say that, yes, things can fail. And once it fails, I have no idea what it will say. I have no idea, given that sort of the bit error rate device failed, I have no idea what is going to output, right? So the goal is to perform good failure detection, and sort of in the sort of networking literature, you can think about it as overcoming, let's say, K point of failures. This is like K arbitrary failures, and when you say arbitrary, it's implicitly adversarial. So now I can start describing the models, first in a picture, and then sort of in a more mathematical way. So we have a true state of the world. Think of Y as being Boolean, either spam or not spam, failed or not failed. And given the true state of the world, we see some kind of observation. This is called our spam detectors or our network detectors. The new feature that we are going to add into here is an adversary. The adversary can sort of modify the things that we observe and output something different. We'll discuss two models. In the first model, which is a simpler one, sort of the adversary picks a modification rule. So the main difference here in the model is sort of where are we going to get the handle over the results? The adversary is going to be restricted. It's going to be restricted by having a finite set of modification rules from which it can select how to create the corruption. So in the static model, he has to select one modification rule that will run sort of for any sequence. In the adaptive model, he can both see the observation and given the observation, he's going to select a modification rule.
So what's the point in the adaptive model of saying that it's a rule? You might as well just select.
Because I wanted to say, because I want it on one, right. So I wanted like a unified notation.
But generally the adaptive model, so it looks at the x's and it outputs the z's.
Yes, right, I agree. So what's the model? We have a binary state of nature. We have a set of signals, just think of it like n-bit vectors. And then we have a joint distribution over the state of nature and the n-bits. And we assume that this signal is a prior distribution. We assume it's known. What we really need is to be computable. Basically, given the x's and y, we can compute those probabilities. In one of the results, we also need it to be samplable. This is a minor issue. Okay, being it compute, okay. When I say that this is computable, in a sense, I'm saying I can solve the inference problem, right? Because what is the inference problem? The inference problem is that given the x's, I need to plug y0 and y1, get two probabilities, and now I can sort of find the conditional. So by saying that things are computable, I'm hiding the fact that I'm assuming that the problem without corruption is solvable, which naturally I should, right? So I want to solve something sort of stronger. And we have a set of observable singlets. So now, I like sort of to stay with the notation of modification. So modification will sort of map the state of the world and an input and give you an observed value. And sort of, we'd like to assume that it's done in polynomial time because we'd like to simulate them. And we assume that it's a bounded number, let's say, M modification rules. So there's like two examples. So one example is that like you can flip a single bit. Modification rule I flips the I-th observation. This is like in the spam detection, flipping one filter. It doesn't have to be like a small number. You can also think of a modification rule that flips all the odd signals, right? Sort of in the network failure, you can sort of, with one failure, you can have a huge cascading effect. What is the goal? The goal is observe Z, predict Y.
So the adversary picks one of the M modification rules and applies it?
Yes. Okay. So the adversary, okay. So I think it's on this slide again. So the predictor is given Z, predicts Y. And implicitly it defines really a policy that given Z gives a prediction, it could be probabilistic, it will be. The adversary sort of selects a modification rule. In the static case, he selected before the realization. In the adaptive case, after the realization. So now we can, both the cases, we can think of this as a zero-sum game. Zero-sum between the predictor and the adversary. So the error is once we fix the policy and the modification rule, we can compute the error very simply. We would like to look at the minimax error. So this would be the error of the best policy. Right. We'd let the predictor move first. He's going to choose a policy, which can be probabilistic. And then the adversary, given the policy, can select the worst-case modification rule. And what we'll be interested also is like epsilon optimal. Epsilon optimal meaning that the error rate is epsilon above the optimal error rate. Okay, so what's our main result? So it's, right. So for the inference problem, we can show the following. Right. Given the observable signals, we can compute a prediction for Y. It's going to be near optimal, and it's going to be efficient, both in the static case and in the adaptive case. Really, there is going to be a different dependency on the number of modification rules. Well, here it's going to be polynomial. Here it's going to be exponential. I'm going to talk today only about this case, about the adaptive case. We do have a bunch of more results regarding learning. So what do I mean by learning? So in the inference setting, we don't restrict ourselves how do we make a prediction. In learning, you usually think about that we have a finite class of hypotheses, and we need sort of to select one of them. So in this learning setting, we're sort of starting with a clean training and like to sort of build a good predictor for a corrupted testing. And what we can show that given a sample, find an optimal or a near optimal in polynomial time, given an oracle for risk minimization, and then show a generalization bound that shows that this is good. Okay. So basically, in the rest of the talk, what I would like really to highlight is the adaptive case, which I think is interesting, and it will give a very interesting relationships also to local algorithm. Before I go there, sort of, when does it make a difference to think about robustness, right? So in some sense, what should we expect from robustness, even before looking at this slide? So we should expect not to put too much weight on anything specific. And here's how it will turn out like in a regular learning setting. So think about learning with the hyperplane. Usually, we'd like to minimize the error. So we'd like to find a hyperplane that minimizes the number of mistakes. You can add a margin like in an SVM setting. Okay. And now let's think about a simple adversary that takes one of the attributes and zeroes it. Right. And for simplicity, just let's think of a uniform distribution. So for a static adversary, he's going, given W, he's going sort of to zero out the highest weight. This is the thing that would cause the most error. For an adaptive adversary, he's going to zero out the highest weight, which is predicting in the right direction. So when you compare this thing to this, it almost looks like a margin, but it's like an adaptive margin. The margin depends on the weights. And this is in line with our intuition that we don't want to put too much weight on any single point, on any single example. Okay. So now I can start talking about the adaptive adversary. So let's first try to model everything using graphs. And then the question would become much more combinatorial. So we'll have two graphs. The first graph is the corruption graph. So really, this is what Boaz was saying. Really, we don't need any modification rules. We just need to say how X's are maps to Z. So given a point X, we have a mapping from the X to the possible Z's that the adversary can select. And this is going to be a bipartite graph going from X to Z. We will have a bounded degree. The bounded degree on the X side is coming from the fact that we have a finite number of modification, a bounded number of modification rules, and we will need to assume the same on the in degree on the other side. Okay. So the next graph is like an interference graph. And this would be the graph it would be. Okay. And we will, okay, we do need also to put weights on the nodes according to the distribution. The next graph is an interference graph. So really, we are talking about Boolean functions. So there is, we can split all the inputs to two parts, the positives and the negatives. And now we build a different bipartite graph. The bipartite graph basically connects two points, connects a negative point to a positive point if there exists some observable signal, Z, which they can both be mapped into. Okay? So now we get, again, a bipartite graph here. And we'll have also weights on the nodes. Again, so here note that the weights are on both sides because those are the axes. And the weight of a node is just its probability according to the prior distribution. Okay, so let's try to think, how would an adversary policy look like? So for simplicity, let's for now assume that it's unweighted. We'll get back to the weighted case. So here is a possible adversary policy. Let's build a matching, right? So we build the matching in the interference graph. So now, a possible policy is we build a matching when X is realized, right? Will match X to X prime if he's part of the matching. So this would imply that any edge in the matching guarantees that we have exactly one error, right? So regardless how we'll predict, we'll have to get one error per edge, which means that the error rate is the size of the maximum matching over N. N is the number of points, okay? So this is just a possible adversary policy. So now let's look at a possible, In the unweighted, in the non-uniform case, we can do something very similar. We basically do a fractional matching, sort of. We do a fractional matching, and then we get sort of something very similar, but just probabilistic. I probably would skip over this slide. Just trust me that we can do it. Now I want to talk about the predictor policy. So predictors, what he will do, he's going to build a vertex cover. So in this example, the yellow nodes are the vertex cover. And now given the vertex cover, let's see how he will predict. So what he will do, he's given some Z. He's going back to the corruption graph and looking at the pre-images of Z. So if this is a Z, we look at those three nodes. And what he's going to do, he's going to ignore the nodes which are in the vertex cover and just pick any one of the remaining nodes and predict according to it. The important observation is that the pre-images of any Z, once you sort of eliminate the nodes in the vertex cover, cannot have both a positive and a negative pre-images. So this means that the error rate is the size of the vertex cover over N. So now we have an optimal policy, at least in the uniform distribution case, because the minimum size of a vertex cover equals the maximum size of a matching, and therefore they have to be identical. So this implies that for optimal policy, the optimal predictor policy is deterministic. I didn't do the non-uniform case, but it will be still deterministic also non-uniformly. The adversary policy would be sort of randomized. It does give us a polynomial time algorithm, but don't be confused. Polynomial time here is not good, because polynomial time is polynomial in the size of a state space, and this is not what we want. We want something which is really running in something polynomial in the dimension. So think about x as 0 to the n, 0, 1 to the n. We want to run in time polynomial in n. So if we want to run in time polynomial in n, it's clearly that we cannot read all the x's. So this is where local algorithm comes in very nicely and sort of, I think, gives it like an incredibly interesting motivation to look at local computations. So first of all, what are local algorithms? So here's sort of a setting that local algorithms usually look at. So you're given a problem, let's say matching in a graph. With the problem, there's a set of queries. So in a matching, you can think that given an edge, answer whether the edge is in the matching or not in the matching. So the idea is that you'd like to reply to specific queries fast, logarithmic time, and you'd like to have no pre-computation or storage, or at least storage, I'd probably sort of later say, how am I cheating? But this is what you really would like to know. And now you can eventually you can sort of query on all the edges. So you would like that the output is a feasible solution. And okay, so until here it's very easy because I can always say no. No edges in the matching, but they would like a near optimal. So one thing that you can show, you can get a local matching algorithm, and I'll try sort of to sketch it later, that will run in polylogarithmic times. The O notation here does hide bad dependency on epsilon and on D, and that's very good. So, and we will need some kind of randomness. So I'm going to use some kind of storage, fixed storage, really to store a seed of randomness. But this is, I would claim, not really a pre-computation, but it's more like a seed that I need later in order to get the randomness working. So let's start with the local matching algorithm. So what is the idea? How can you get a local matching algorithm without inspecting the entire graph and get a near optimal matching? So here is the main observation, which is well known. Right? You can, when you look at matching, you look at augmentation paths. Augmentation paths sort of start with a known edge not in the matching and alternates between them and adds in another edge not in the matching. And Hopkopf and Kraft in 73, what they showed is that if there is no augmentation path, then it's an optimal matching. This is well known. But they showed that if there is no short augmentation path, then you are near optimal. So what does it imply locally? So think that if you sort of fix this k to be 1 over epsilon, you would get a 1 minus epsilon matching if you can check that there are no local compute local augmentation path. So there is like a distributed algorithm that is based on this idea and gets a near optimal matching. And what it really does is it's work in phases and sort of checks whether there are augmentation paths. So it basically takes a maximal set of augmentation paths, edits to the matching, and the new matching is guaranteed that although it doesn't have any short augmentation path. Okay? So what we did is sort of, when you get a local matching, you can sort of simulate the distributed algorithm. But where do things sort of, you need to be careful? So one place is, right, so you recursively check whether an edge in the matching of K and in the augmentation of K, and if it's in one and not the other, it will remain to the next stage. The main thing is sort of has to go in how do you build this set AK, which I'll probably sort of jumping over. And this gives us the, right, by doing this building in a correct way and careful, you can get the polylogarithmic running time.
How does the consistency work?
Because you are really simulating, okay, you have like 1/ε phases. In each phase, you're taking one, phase one is augmentation paths of length 1, augmentation paths of length 3, length 5. And in each phase, you're really generating a matching. What you need now sort of to unravel this is sort of given an edge, you want to say, is it in the matching of number 5? It's in the matching of number 5 if it was in number 3 and wasn't augmented, or if it was augmented in number 3 and was not in number, right? And then there's sort of you need to go down an exponential size 3,
so
but the exponential is in 1/ε.
Any distributed algorithm that runs for k steps is k local because you just simulate it, right? That's the... So
you need to be more careful.
On a network and
yes,
you only look
right.
for distance k.
Yes.
And that's exactly the k locality.
Yes.
Equivalent to your k locality, right?
Right. But the point is that you need. But the algorithms which are doing distributedly are using much more computation per node. So the question is sort of why am I looking at very long histories? Because they are carrying the histories in era. Okay. Maybe we can take it.
No.
Okay. I hope to get like in the 1-2 minutes that I have to get sort of, okay. So this was matching. And matching is really, it's great if you want to be an adversary, but we want to be the good guys. We want to be the predictors. So we need to go from matching to vertex cover. So there are like regular ways of going from matching to a vertex cover. The problem is that this is sort of the standard way of going. Given a maximum matching, you can sort of define a vertex cover in the following way. Take the unmatched node, those are going to be level 0, and now for each node you compute its level from the unmatched node, and take the all the odd levels. And this is going to be a minimum vertex cover. The problem is we don't have a real matching, we have an approximate matching. And the approximate matching would not translate well with this vanilla procedure. We'll need sort of to do a tiny perturbation of it. And the tiny perturbation is that we shouldn't be, okay, we need to use two randomization really. One is that we need to take a random cutoff point rather than to go until the end, rather than counting until the 1/ε, take a cut somewhere in between. And the other thing we need to sort of select sort of for the things which are outside, we need to select one of the sides at random. And given this, we will be able to do it, right? So if the alternating path from V is less than R, if it's odd, it's going to be in the approximate vertex cover. And if it's more than R, we put it in the vertex cover only if it's sort of in the side that we selected.
This is all vertex cover in a bipartite graph,
yes.
Right? Okay.
Right. No, this is why it's polynomial. Sorry. Right. Okay. So it's always a vertex cover, and the expectation is going to be near optimum. So just putting everything together for a wrap up. So what is sort of the algorithm? We want to predict a certain value. We compute the pre-images of a that lead to it. Those are the axes that can lead to it, right? And now we want to find some x which is not in the vertex cover and predict according to it. How do we know which vertex point, which one of those axes is in the vertex cover? For each of them, we need sort of to compute whether they are in the vertex cover or not. Basically, we sort of test whether they are part of the matching. If they are part of the matching, we do need to sort of look on the alternating path from them to the free node and see whether they're part of the vertex cover. Okay. This is sort of, I'm over time, so let me just conclude. Okay. So my main objective was to try to convince you that robust probabilistic inference is an interesting question. I didn't talk about the static adversary. I did talk about the adaptive adversary. And I think what was, at least for me, very interesting and surprising for the adaptive adversary is that it connects in a very natural way to local algorithms. And somehow, sort of, I suspect that many inference problems can be casted as local algorithm questions. What is very nice for me is that we got very natural graph algorithmic problems, matching, vertex cover, bipartite graph is very good because we can know how to solve them. And given those, we can derive sort of the inference algorithm. I didn't talk about the learning, so I just keep it here. And I'm done.
Comments. So there were these works by like people like Onak and Gwen on these local algorithms for yes. matching, vertex cover. How are they related to these?
So this algorithm that I mentioned here, that I did with Shai Vardi, is sort of generating a maximal matching. I think what they did is sort of, we didn't generate them something which is maximal, but they did generate something which is sort of still near optimal. There's also like a follow-up work of other people which can get it, the matching part to be sort of deterministic and not randomized. But here is sort of one thing that I was sort of, when we worked on it, it took me some time to realize that it doesn't work. So why, like while you can get good approximation on the matching side, getting a direct approximation on the vertex cover, I wasn't able to do, although you can write greedy algorithm for the vertex cover that will get the optimum if you run them, but somehow stopping them early is looks like a very bad solution.
The other? No, thank you, Shai, again. Okay.